Good morning. Welcome to Grace Alameda's online service. We're glad that you joined us today. Our call to worship comes from 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. And it says this: "See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is." Will you pray with me? Father God, through the gracious work of your Son, you have adopted us, daughters and sons, in your kingdom. We pray that you would send your Holy Spirit into our hearts to cry, "Abba, Father," to you, that we may rejoice in your mercy and become like our Savior, Jesus Christ. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Now and forever, sinful hearts. He is our great Redeemer. Sing to Jesus, honor His name. Sing of His faithfulness, pouring His life out unto death.
Welcome again to Grace Alameda. My name is Jeff Locke. I'm one of the pastors here. And if you're joining us for the first time, we would love to hear from you. In the description box, there's a link, gracealameda.org/contact, where we would love to hear from you, how we can pray for you, and give us the opportunity to follow up and connect with you. If Grace Alameda is your home, we want to encourage you to give at this time. There is a link below. Please click there and give faithfully to God that which He has given to us in His generosity and grace. And finally, again, after service today, there will be a Zoom fellowship time. The password was sent out earlier this week in the newsletter as well as on Slack. So please click there and join us. We'd love to see you. I'd love to get some time face to face. At this time, I want to invite you to take some time to pray with me. Father God, we pray that you would grant to all of us, your people, to withstand the temptations of the world, the flesh, and the devil. And with pure hearts and minds, that you would help us to follow you, the only God. We pray, Father, that you would remember those at this time who are suffering unemployment, suffering want, suffering anxiety due to lack of work or how they're going to pay their bills. Father, we pray that you would guide the people of this land, that we would so use our public and private wealth, that everyone among us may find suitable and fulfilling employment and receive a just reward for their labor. Father God, you have created all things. It's by your Son that you commanded us to love our enemies and to pray for those who persecute us. We pray, Father God, for our enemies, that you would lead them and us from prejudice to truth, that you would deliver them and us from hatred, cruelty, and revenge. And we pray that in your good time, you would enable us all to stand reconciled before you in Christ Jesus, your Son. Father God, You are the God who created all things. You are very light. And it's your light that divides the day from the night and turns the shadow of death into the morning. We pray that you would drive far from us all wrong desires, that you would incline our hearts to keep your law, that you would guide our feet into the way of peace, and that having done your will with cheerfulness during the day, we may, when night comes, rejoice and give you thanks. We pray all of these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Well, our scripture reading for today comes from Psalm 130, and it says this: Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my pleas for mercy. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, that you may be feared. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than watchmen for the morning, more than watchmen for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plentiful redemption. And he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities. This is the word of God. Let's pray. Lord, we ask that you would bless us as we come to your word, as we reflect on its truth, as we seek to learn and know what it means to wait upon you in these difficult times and hours. Lord, may our trust in you, may it grow, may it mature as we reflect on who Jesus is and what he's done and how he meets us in this particular time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, I'm back from paternity leave. It was a good month to settle into a new life with two daughters now. I want to thank Grace Alameda so much for your love and support for our family, which is still ongoing right now. It has not been an easy transition, I must say. Having two children is as difficult as they say it is, but God has been very gracious, and a lot of that grace and love that he has shown has been through Grace Alameda and the various people in this church. So thank you so much for your support during this time. Not a lot of you probably know this, but before Naomi was born, while Janice was still pregnant with her, we had a pretty scary and nervous moment with the pregnancy. Back in February, due to abnormal test results, a doctor had contacted us, concerned that Naomi may have a genetic disorder. All types of variances were possible. They couldn't really tell us exactly if something was for sure or not, but they requested that we come in for an in-depth ultrasound to get some idea if there was an issue or a problem. And so we went in for the ultrasound. It was longer than any normal ultrasound that we've ever had. They took way more measurements and pictures than usual. And when the technician left, they told us the doctor would be in to discuss the results very soon. And we waited. We waited in the waiting room for about, I think it ended up only being no more than 5 to 6 minutes, but as you can understand, our hearts felt like it was an eternity, an agonizing eternity. Waiting there, running through the gamut of emotions and thoughts of what life might be like if Naomi were not to be a healthy baby, or if there were some issues or complications with her. And the amazing amount of prayer that happened in 5 to 6 minutes. Thankfully, the doctor came in and said everything looked fine and that we had no particular reason to worry. But those 5 to 6 minutes of waiting for the doctor were perhaps the longest 5 to 6 minutes of my life. Waiting can be really hard. We're in a world right now where we have to wait for a lot of things. We have to wait to go into grocery stores now. We have to wait right now for clean air because we can't even go for a walk with our kids with the smoke outside. Waiting is even harder when the stakes are higher, too. For a lot of people, they're waiting for justice to be served because of various injustices that have happened in this nation. A lot of us are waiting for a vaccine so we can be with our friends and family again, so we can worship in one building again as a church. And in this waiting, during this time of waiting, maybe you're like me and you've been asking and praying and wondering, God, when will you do something? God, when will you show up? We need you here. This is not a foreign emotion to Scripture. You know, our psalm today echoes this very thought, and that's what we're going to explore, this idea of waiting on God. We're going to look at two things. One is waiting with recognition, and then waiting with hope. What does it mean to wait with a recognition, and then what does it mean to wait with hope? If you grew up in America, like I did, born in the United States and have lived here my whole life, you probably at this moment in this time feel like this is a country you do not recognize anymore. You know, I feel like a stranger in a strange land at a strange time. Politically and socially, I can't say that, at least in my 39 years here in America, that I have ever lived in an America that's been more divided ever. And in certain pockets across this country, I know that that's not true, that people have experienced way deeper, way more serious political and social divisions than anything I've experienced in my time. And so I'm willing to admit that, but I'm just saying for my own life, this is the strangest time politically and socially I've ever lived in. Local sense, it's definitely, I grew up in the Bay Area. I was raised in the Bay Area, and I don't remember growing up in the Bay and having to wear masks because of pandemics or dealing with yearly wildfire smoke or wildfires in general. This isn't something that happened when I was a child growing up in the Bay Area. So all this, everything going on right now is so weird, and it's so strange, and frankly, incredibly sad. It's a world I don't recognize, and you probably don't recognize it too. What I do recognize, however, there's something I do recognize. What I do recognize, however, are that my old patterns of behavior in dealing with what's going on around my life and around this world right now, I recognize those patterns that I fall into and revert to in these unfortunate circumstances. I recognize this tendency I have to be frustrated and anxious and to lack patience. I recognize my self-righteousness over the stupidest things. I recognize that this anger that I have perhaps toward racism and how people are being treated or treating one another, very often isn't that different. It's on the same level as my anger toward a late food delivery from DoorDash, that I get angry now over the weirdest things and how they're equal in the same ferocity of it. That there's something, I recognize that problem within me, that issue in me. And I think ultimately what I'm really recognizing is this, that waiting is hard. Waiting is hard. Waiting for change to happen is hard, but it's not because of what's around me, but it's because of what's within me that makes waiting so hard. Not what's around me, but what's within me that makes this so hard. I'm the main reason why waiting is so hard. And the psalmist in chapter 130 recognizes this reality as well. You know, as he cries out to God for help, he says in verse 1, out of the depths of my soul, out of the very bottom of the barrel of who I am, he's clearly describing some worst case scenario that he possibly can be, because nobody talks about crying out from the depths of themselves unless they are at the end of their rope and they have no other possible solution. And for some people, you might read that passage and think, well, they must be going through some really difficult outer circumstances. They must be suffering something from outside of them, a form of oppression, a persecution from outside. And yet the psalmist actually seems to be pointing not to something, not to external influences, but to be pointing about something that's inner turmoil, something that's working in their own heart. Because it's out of these depths he cries out in verse 3, if you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? There is this suffering within the psalmist's heart, the spiritual turmoil within that he's working through and struggling with and can't seem to get out of. And it's recognizing that the problems are not outside of himself, but within him, and that's what he needs to deal with before God. He's concerned about his standing before God and not before the world. Whatever situation he's currently in, whatever obstacles he's currently facing, what he recognizes is the need for change must begin within himself. And that's what cannot be lost in this time and place. You know, in a time where so many of us, and you hear this cry on television, if you read the blogs or any sort of letters or emails or whatever, that the cry in this time is a call for change in the world. A call, churches will call out to God to change. We pray to God to change our current situations and circumstances. But the reality is we can only do that with a good heart and an understanding first of recognizing that we ourselves must call on God to change us. That we ourselves must examine our own hearts and our own depths of our soul and stand before God and be right with him before we have any right or any place or any standing to call God to make right all the wrongs in this world. Now, don't misunderstand me here. I'm not saying that there isn't a place for social or political or personal action when particular situations arise. I'm not saying that we as Christians or people who follow Jesus have to be handcuffed and can never speak out or never act whenever there's a good reason to do so. We all have convictions given to us by God that we need to live by in order to love our neighbor best, and in order to honor God best. And those convictions for each and every one of us are going to probably look a little different. But what we must recognize is that we have a need to change first before we can demand God change the world around us. Because the reality is God can change the world around us, but if our hearts are still fixated on ourselves, if they're still fixated on creating kingdoms that please us, then God can change all things. But if we're not changed, we will always be anxious. We will always be disappointed. We will always be frustrated. Furthermore, the reality is by our own merit, by our own standing, we have no more right to stand before God than any politician, any police officer, or any protester. None of us naked before God, without His protection, have a right to stand before Him and make demands of Him. That's what we must recognize as we wait for God to act, to recognize our need for Him to act on us first. And as we recognize this need, as we recognize God at work in us, we can then begin to wait with hope. To wait with hope. Another theme that I've seen come out in a lot of our culture right now, because of the difficulties we're facing, is that there's this theme of fear, right? Fear is dictating so much of what is going on in our world right now, right? You have the fear that some people have of COVID. And so that's why they're telling everyone they need to wear masks, because we fear this disease that spreads via airborne particles. And so everyone should wear masks because of it. And at the same time, there are people who are telling others, you shouldn't wear masks. There's no need to wear masks, because there's a fear for them of losing civil liberties and their rights to be able to live the way they want. Regardless if you think one is correct over the other, right? The point is they're both agendas are really driven by a sense of fear in a lot of cases, right? You think about some of the campaign ads that now you see on TV or on the internet. A lot of them no longer seek to inspire hope for the future. But almost every campaign ad is cynical. It's seeking to instill fear into people's hearts of this could happen if the opponent becomes our leader. There's no real sense of this is what will happen if you choose our candidate to become president. And it's strange, this current atmosphere of fear that we live in, all of it is just rooted in this cold, hard demand for justice to be served, right? For righteousness to be upheld, for things to be made right. And if you choose this person, they will accomplish this. Or if you act this way, we can accomplish this. But what's going on is, as all this rhetoric is going in one direction of driving people to live in this particular type of fear, it's also driving people to live without any hope for redemption or for restoration. It drives people to fear in this way by shaming a whole other group of people, by guilting people, like, and telling them, why aren't you living the way that we're supposed to live, right? It's a fear that our culture is caught up in right now, a fear that leads to terror, a fear that leads to dread, a fear that leads, just to a following blindly. The Bible tells us to fear God as well. But we have to understand that this is a different kind of fear that the Bible talks about. Here in Psalm 130, in verse 4, it says that because God is forgiving, that people will fear Him. Fear is not only rooted in justice. The fear of God in Scripture is not just about serving justice and accomplishing righteousness, but it's a fear that is rooted in God's forgiveness as well. It's rooted in His love as well. Christian counselor Ed Welch calls the fear of the Lord a reverent submission that leads to obedience. It's a fear that calls people to trust and worship God because He is loving, and He's not just great, He's not just just and righteous, though He very much is those things, but it's also to fear God because He's loving and forgiving and He's gracious. And so it doesn't lead us to shame others. It doesn't lead us to oppress others, but it leads us to follow Him. And where do we see this most clearly? In all the Bible, where do we see most clearly this type of fear of God, a healthy fear, the fear that our culture doesn't know what to do with or make sense of? Where do we see it in the Bible? We see it at the cross of Jesus Christ. You know, at the cross is where you see the Son of God being plunged into the depths of anguish for you and for me. Yeah, at the cross, Jesus pays the price for you, that He takes the punishment for you so that you can receive the forgiveness that God offers. And in this way, you receive His mercy. You receive His love because Jesus has taken that punishment for you. You are now reconciled to God, but only by the sacrifice of His Son. So when you look at the cross, you can stand bold and courageous and be confident that you are right with God and that He hears you and that He answers you, that His justice and His righteousness is for you, that His love and forgiveness and mercy are for you. You learn to fear God because of this, because He has paid the price Himself. Right? He has paid the price to forgive and restore you. And that's the reality we don't have in our world today. Because no social justice movement will pay the price for you. No vaccine will pay the price for you. No president can pay the price for you. None of them can accomplish this for you. They will all demand that you change first in order to get better. This is why, like the psalmist, we can wait with hope. We can wait with hope like watchmen wait for the morning. Like watchmen wait for the morning, as we see in verse 6. Yeah, I had a friend back in my seminary days who, while he was studying at the seminary and also interning at the same church that I was interning at, in order to make ends meet, also was a security guard who worked the graveyard shift. He was a night watchman. And he's a great friend, and it was really hard sometimes to see him at meetings because he would come in just bleary-eyed and clearly exhausted because of the late and long hours that he had spent. And I asked him, you know, what is it like? What is it like being a late night security guard, especially in light of all the other responsibilities that you have? How are you dealing with it? And he told me that it was advantageous to be a night security guard because he was able to get so much studying done. And it was because he was often by himself. There's at night, nobody needs a security guard to do anything. Generally speaking, all he needs to do is make sure there's no one prowling around who shouldn't be prowling around. And so he was able to get a lot of work done, and in seminary, you had to study a lot. However, he did mention that there were some nights that were so difficult, so exhausting, where he felt so broken that he just felt like this night would never end, that the sun was never going to come up, and he was going to be permanently a night watchman. Think about how hopeless and how broken you have to be to think that morning would never come, right? Something that has happened every single day of each and every one of our lives. Maybe if you lived in the Arctic Circle where, you know, they get night for 24 hours in one day because of the certain time of year it is. But for all of us who've never lived in such cold environments, the sun has always risen. Morning has always come. But to be in a place where you are so broken, exhausted, and beaten down that you at some moment believe that today will be the first time that the sun will not rise for you. What hopelessness must you have to think that? And maybe some of us actually feel that way right now, or we're on the edge of that because you're tired of the smoke. You're tired of wearing a mask. You're tired of all the yelling on TV. And you're tired of talking about politics. And you're tired of wildfires. And you're tired of the CDC. You're tired of it all. I want you to remember that waiting on God is not a hopeless waiting, but it is hopeful, because our God is with us, and he's shown that by the cross of Christ. There is a morning to come. We can wait on the morning to come after this long night that we are in right now, because our Lord has a steadfast love for us. It's a love that's freely and graciously given. It's not earned or deserved, but it's unchanging and faithful. Though the whole world around us may be changing constantly, as it says in verse 7, God's love remains steadfast. It exists because God has committed himself to preserving us and to being with us. You know, everywhere right now, this culture around us demands that you need to change in order to be fully accepted and loved. But God gives you his steadfast love in this way, through Jesus Christ. Ephesians 5:8, it says, "But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." Though the world demands that you change to fit how the world is changing, for you to have any sort of hope, you need to become what the world calls you to be, right? The gospel says that we are first loved by God, and then we have hope to change. And then we can be changed. Friends, we are not waiting right now for a chance that things might get better. But we are waiting with a guarantee from our Lord that the sun will rise and this night will end. We're not waiting on a wish, we're waiting on a promise. This is why we can confess that not only has Christ died and Christ has risen, but the confession is also that Christ will come again. And in your suffering, in your struggle, in your long night, Christ will come again. Take hope. Recognize that he is here with you. And so just to leave us with two really quick thoughts on how do we do that? How do we wait with hope in this time? Two quick applications to consider. First, go to the Lord in honest prayer. That's exactly what the psalmist does in Psalm 130. Go to the Lord in honest prayer. Be fearless. Be forthright with God. He's not afraid to hear your fears, to hear your worries, or hear your anger. But out of the depths of who you are, out of your desperation, cry out to him. Don't hold it in. Don't keep it silent. But cry out to God and know that he hears you, because he's a God whose steadfast love is for you. He's a God that delights in forgiving and welcoming. And he's a God that delights in your worship. So pray to him, call out to him, and be honest with him. Secondly, scripture here tells us that we are to hope in his word, right? In verse 5, the psalmist says, "In his word I hope." And the reality is there is no struggle or sickness or sorrow that scripture cannot speak to. Right? There's not much about pandemics, sure, in Scripture, but Scripture does talk a lot about how to deal with suffering. And this is why we need God's Word, Because there are saints throughout history here in Scripture that we see, people like Abraham, David, the psalmists, as they write their psalms and sing their praises and their troubles to God. The Apostle Paul, different people who we have their testimonies of how they have gone through suffering by the grace of God and the love and forgiveness of God and how they've dealt with it. But most importantly, the Word gives us the testimony of Christ. It gives us a picture of the cross, Jesus who gave his life for us so that we might know the steadfast love of God and we might wait in hope in these times of hopelessness, that we might look and gaze upon the Son of God as we wait for him to return. And so as we close today, wait with hope, wait with trust, wait in Christ. Go to him, look to him, pray to him, and place your hope in him alone. Let's pray. Father, Lord, as we come to you, as we look to you and rejoice in knowing that God, only you alone can make sense of this time. Father, we fear you. We submit to you. We obey, not because, Lord, you demand this first in order for us to receive your love, but it's because you have loved us first. It's because you've already forgiven us in Christ that we can move forth in obedience and trust. Father, I especially want to pray for those who are going through a long night, who are going through a difficult time where they're losing hope that the sun might rise again for them, that the sun might rise on their health, that the sun might not rise on their job, that the sun might not rise on their marriage or on their family. Father, I pray your mercy would be made known, that your love would rest upon them, that God, you would meet them in this place, that Jesus would show up in those places for them. And even if it doesn't happen immediately, that God, we would all continue to wait with hope. For we know that our Savior has died, our Savior has risen, and our Savior will come again. In his name we pray, amen. Well, at this time, we have our confession of sin, which comes from 1 John chapter 3, verses 17 and 18, and it reads this. But if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Little children, let us not love in word or talk, but in deed and in truth. You know, we talk today about recognizing our own need for change as we express desires for change around us to happen. And we place these expectations and we make demands on others on how they should act toward us. But there are always ways in which we're guilty of failing to love our neighbors, and most importantly, failing to love God as well. So let's take a moment in silent meditation and prayer to search our own hearts for ways in which we've done this and confess them to God now. Let's do that in the quiet of this moment. Our assurance of faith comes from 1 John chapter 3, verses 19 through 20, and it reads this. By this we shall know that we are of the truth and reassure our heart before him. For whenever our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart, and he knows everything. As we have confessed, God's steadfast love for his church means he's quick to forgive. Know that you do not stand before him as a criminal or as an orphan, but you stand before him as a beloved child, set free from any and all condemnation. So let's rejoice and let's sing in response.
From the depths of woe I raise to thee the voice of lamentation. Lord, turn a gracious ear to me and hear my supplication. If thou iniquities dost mark, our secret sins and misdeeds dark, oh, who shall stand before thee?
Who shall stand before thee?
Oh, who shall stand before thee?
Who shall stand before thee?
To wash away the crimson stain, grace alone availeth. Our works, alas, are all in vain. In much the best life faileth. No man can glory in thy sight. All must alike confess thy might and live alone by mercy. Doubteth not nor feareth. Do thus, O ye of Israel's seed, ye of the Spirit born indeed, and wait till God appeareth. Shepherd good and true is he, who will at last his Israel free from all their sin and sorrow.
All their sin and
from all
The benediction, God's blessing to us, his people, comes today from 1 John chapter 3, verses 21 and 22. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence before God. And whatever we ask, we receive from him because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he commanded us. May you know today that even if your heart condemns you, God does not condemn you if you are in Christ. May you go with that peace, and may that give you joy throughout the week. God bless you, and have a wonderful Sunday.